This is going to be more perhaps lecture-oriented today than some of the following next 3 weeks. My hope is that we will have time, including a little bit of time tonight, to talk amongst yourselves or for us to have a plenary conversation. But there's a lot of material here, and I'm going to weight it on the front end. And so with that in mind, I will jump right in. Our first week, we're going to talk about the theory of authentic happiness and the positive emotions and flow that come with that. We will then next week take on human flourishing, which is a new theory by Martin Seligman, along with many other positive psychologists, and we'll address some of those others, Ed Diner in Illinois, Lucy Cohn in New Zealand, and some others. Week three, we'll deal with the downside, with vulnerability and shame, principally using Brene Brown's resources. And I should just stop and say that Martin Seligman's Authentic Happiness and more recent book, Flourish, are available in the bookshop, as is Brene Brown's Daring Greatly. I understand that Brene actually is at Town Hall tonight, but we're going to talk about her, not this week. Actually, not much tonight, but what a gifted teacher she is. I was first exposed to this material 5 or 6 years ago by a fellow priest named Lowell Grisham, who had read these books and taught some about it and didn't agree with all the science of authentic happiness then. I still don't, and yet I think there's much about it that is compelling, which is the reason that I'm offering it. Some of its science, I think, is a little bit soft. You may think so too, but I think it's worth our consideration. My purpose here is not to cite all of the details of the science. We're not going to get down into p-values, so just ease up. PhD mathematician over here, I'm a little bit intimidated. You can read about the science in its detail in those books, and if you go Google Seligman, you can get all sorts of lectures of his. I have a few hypotheses. The first one is that I believe that we were created to be joyful. Or, as a scientist, I might say that we have evolved with the capacity to be joyful. I think that those are the statements that are one and the same. We, as people of faith, believe that we were made in the image of God, right? And as a result of that, because we know that God delights in God's creation, the whole of it, that creation is in turn invited to delight in God's design for us. And that's what I think undergirds all of this, whether we're talking the science or the theology or putting it all together, that we were invited into something that is rich and rewarding and life-giving, not only for us, but for those around us, and indeed for all of creation. So what Seligman calls happiness, and he's gotten a lot of grief for calling it that, I might call by another name, joy, for example. But let's wade in. And let me just say at the outset that there's a slippery slope with some of this that I don't intend to go down, but I don't want you to go down either. And that is the slippery slope of the prosperity gospel, right? Meaning that if you just live right well enough, then you will be successful, you'll be wealthy, you'll be happy, you'll be blissful, and nothing will touch you, and it's bunk. So let's just name it and parenthetically put it off to the side. This is an invitation, not about how to. I don't think that how to and guides really work. We'll say more about that sometime, but I think that this is not about how to, this is about an invitation to be truly who you were created to be, which is, I think, joyful. It's true identity work. So, positive psychology is a field of study about positive emotions. These are momentary or brief experiences of positive emotions, things like joy or flow or glee or pleasure or contentment or serenity or hope or ecstasy. But it's also about the connection of that with love and gratitude. As I mentioned, there's these two principal resources, Seligman's work at the University of Pennsylvania and Brene Brown's work at the University of Houston. Not everyone universally accepts these theories. Some of you may not either, but we want to tease up some edges. Which brings me to hypothesis number two, and that is that all people long for happiness, for flourishing, for a deeper sense of meaning and purpose. I believe that, and I hope that you might too. We could even call it a presupposition for the series if you like. As people of faith, we lay claim to being part of something larger than ourselves, even larger than the whole universe mystery that that is. And I am convinced that these positive emotions are a key to this work of feeling connected to something larger than us, as our love and gratitude, and they go together. I would even say they're Trinitarian in their flow. You can't be grateful without love. You can't experience love without gratitude. You can't experience joy without love. You can't experience joy without gratitude. You see that in our Trinitarian mystery, that God is and God is not. God is what we name the Father. God is the Father is the Son is not the Son. God is the practice of this theory is that it is a flow between these three elements, each distinct in their own right, but connected and necessarily so. So our thesis for this first week is this. Authentic happiness comes from identifying and cultivating your most fundamental strengths and using them every day in work, play, love, and parenting. A brief further word about happiness. We're not talking about mushy, sappy, glee, or at least not only glee. As I said, Seligman has struggled with this so much so that he has written a new book and said, let's not call it happiness anymore, let's call it flourishing, and let's add a couple more parameters onto it so I can sell some more books. But happiness theory versus flourishing, I think, is not a new theory when you get right down to it. It is, they are connected, they are confluences of one and the other, and we will spend some time with the authentic happiness theory and then overlay that with some of his additional work in flourish theory, mostly next week. There's nothing new here, I should say. Aristotle worked on all of this many, many moons ago, the work of eudaimonia. Some of you may recognize that term. Literally means flourishing, well-being, the fullness of identity lived into. We'll say more about that perhaps next week.
Will you repeat that word?
Eudaimonia. It's E-U, I've got it somewhere in the slides, E-U-D-A-I-M-O-N-I-A. The Greek word just meaning flourishing. And this is what Seligman and others are trying to apprehend once more using the tenets of positive psychology in our modern era. But they're not creating some new paradigm here, because the reality is Aristotle was trying to create a framework to understand what true joy and true flourishing was back then. Jesus was too. Jesus said, I came so that you may have life and have it abundantly, and so that your joy may be complete. That's the language of our scriptures. And so the invitations have been there all along, but how many of us don't hear it in a way that we are actually consciously working with it? It is part and parcel to our Christian tradition. Let me tell you a little bit about Seligman's background. For 30 years, he studied the field of learned helplessness. That if animals experienced electric shock so many times and they couldn't remove whatever the cause of the shock was, that many of them would just learn the helplessness of just giving up and just being shocked and shocked and shocked and just being miserable, sad, and so forth. And yet, there were one out of three never gave up no matter what in his work with the animals. One out of three never would learn that. For some reason, they just kept on going. They had a resilience. There is this parallel for humans, he decided, that made helpless by unsolvable problems, will express passivity. They give up on life and they develop and adopt a sense of passivity in life, which means that they are slower to learn the possible workarounds, that they are connected with sadness and depression at statistically much higher levels. We'll show you a slide in a few minutes about that. But while studying deficits and learning to repair the damage, that is in a disease model sort of way. You know, disease is when something about the human body is not working properly. That's the basic definition. And yet some just don't ever fit into those models. And so that's where it clicked for him about 18 years ago. And he said, why is it that some people manage to be happy, joyful, have these positive emotions more prevalently than others? Why is that evolutionarily the case for some? Why do any of us have the capacity for that evolutionarily? And so that's what he was working on. He did a study of 180 nuns, Sisters of Notre Dame in Milwaukee. Randomized controlled clinical trial adjusted for diet, smoking, drinking, reproductive, marital histories, economic, social class, access to medical care. There were other things too. They took out other factors of how devout they were, how intellectually their essays were, their degree of unhappiness expressed, how much they looked forward to the future, and none of it was correlated with longevity. What was whether they were joyful. And statistically significant, 90% of the most cheerful on his scale were alive at age 85. 54% were alive at age 94. But only 34% of the least cheerful were alive at age 85, I should say, and then 11% at age 94. Lots of data there. You see the difference. The people who are more cheerful lived longer. The nuns were. Does that surprise anybody? No? I wasn't so convinced of that data when I first read and heard about it. But I think it's true. Which brings me to, let me just say there's a couple other studies that he has in his book. One that he looks at yearbooks, and the people who have a certain kind of Duchenne smile, the one where the corners of the lip turn up and the wrinkles, the crow's feet, are present when they smile, like that, Susan, yeah. That they live longer, happier lives. They actually even said they were more happily married and a whole lot of other things. Probably the most inane research that was done that I read about was that they looked at 682 people in undergoing colonoscopies.
What were they looking for?
They were looking at them from all sides. And they were sound asleep, except that the randomized controlled trial, they lengthened the length of the procedure for one side of the trial, an extra, I can't remember if it's 1 minute or 5 minutes, again, it's in the book. But they brought them out of the discomfort of the procedure. That's why they put you to sleep, because it's uncomfortable. I used to do these things. It is uncomfortable. I had it done and put me to sleep. Thank you very much. They brought them out more slowly so that they weren't experiencing pain as they were coming out of the anesthesia. And then the others had a shorter procedure, but it was more uncomfortable at the very end. And the ones that came out had a positive experience, so much so that they were all willing to undergo it the next year if they were asked. God bless them for that. All of that is to say, a third hypothesis is that happiness leads to higher quality of life, longer life, and flourishing. And that's what the data bears out in these theories, in this field of science, time and time again. So let's talk about feelings and traits. pause briefly to say that we're not just talking about feelings only or subjective emotions. So just if you just pretend to be happy all the time, if I tend to say by default, if someone asks me how you doing, I say I'm great, and you? And I really mean that most days. But if someone in my family just died, or I just had a colonoscopy, or whatever the case may be, that's bogus for me to say I'm great. So this is not just about putting on a happy face. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is about actually being authentically true to your emotions. But it's even more than that. Feelings are the emotional states, momentary and fleeting. They have bearing on how we understand happiness. But they lean into traits or characteristics that persist, both positive and negative. And traits influence our experience of those momentary positive emotions. So there's a trait of optimism, that is, we tend to interpret troubles as transient, controllable, specific to one situation. And there's a trait of pessimism, that we tend to believe troubles last forever, undermine everything, are uncontrollable. The Mayo Clinic study said that optimists have a 19% longer life, greater longevity. Authentic happiness is experienced when emotions are practiced, and practice, and practice some more, and experienced as habituated traits that become over time a way that we see the world, a way that we see our lives. Indeed, it's even to a way of understanding life satisfaction. And when we leave tonight, I have actually a survey of life satisfaction for you to take home and take and see. And it has some scales and some statistically relevant ballparks to see where you size up with the rest of your of the population. When we combine that sense of emotions and traits with a feeling of what he says is flow, which really is about engagement in the present. I'll say more about this in a few minutes. But it's engagement and living in the present moment, because this is the one that matters right now. We'll say something about the past and the future and how we perceive those. But we're really talking about that, and then meaning and how we put that together. So let's take just 2 minutes. And I want you to, in just a moment when I say go, I want you to turn to your neighbor, whoever's at your table with you, and just say how, on a scale of 1 to 10, where 1 is, man, you are Eeyore pessimist. And 10 is, you're that one that no one likes to see first thing in the morning because you were just so cheerful. Y'all know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Yeah.
So take about 1 minute, one person talking, the other one just listening, it's not a dialogue. And just say where you are on that continuum generally. 1 to 10, 1 pessimist, 10 very optimistic, and how you feel in that as you go about life. And then after 1 minute, we'll say switch, and then the other one will listen, and the first person that was listening will talk. Does this make sense? All right. I'm looking for those who are Duchenne smilers right now. You cannot talk when you're smiling that brightly. What a wonderful thing to see and hear all of that good energy and lots of smiling going on when it was there. So what I know is, isn't there just great hope for humanity?
Yes.
And someone told me that they are... they are taping the debates tonight, so you can watch it later. That was supposed to be a little sarcasm on the joke about hope. Positive versus negative. Let me just move on, and hopefully we'll have time at the end to have some more plenary interplay. positive versus negative. This is, as I said, it's a positive psychology model, which is counterintuitive. It gets a lot of grief in the world of psychotherapy and in the world of medicine as well. Both are built upon the negative analysis of something's broken, something's wrong, and needs to be fixed. It's not bad in and of itself, but I think at the end of the day, it leaves us wanting for something that honors the fact that we are part of that creation that was designed to delight. And how do we learn how to delight when we're always being told that we're broken? The flip side of that is, if we never hear that we're broken and in need of work, well then we never have the opportunity to really delight because we don't know who we really are. So I hope you hear that it's not a chastising, but it's just one more way for us to think about it. Positive psychology is revolutionary because it focuses on the positive. 24 strengths are available to us in Seligman's model. 6 core virtues that find expression in the strengths. These are the 6 virtues: wisdom and knowledge, courage, love and humanity, justice, temperance, spirituality, and transcendence. Any of you who took Philosophy 101 will recognize that 4 of those are really cardinal virtues in the ancient Greek notion of ethics. But these strengths, and I'll just highlight a couple of them. So there are several in the field of wisdom. There's curiosity, there's love of learning, there's judgment, there's originality, there's social intelligence, there's perspective. And the more that we are able to practice and develop each of those as strengths by which we live, the more likely we are to discover the life satisfaction and ultimately the happiness or the flourishing that comes as a result of embracing these 6 virtues. Love has these: kindness, generosity, nurturance, the capacity to be loved as well as to love. You recognize that love naturally turns outward to something else or someone else. It doesn't make any sense unless that's the case, which is where generosity, this notion of giving away in the language of the church, is about stewardship. But it's the generosity that says we understand and we practice what it is to know love by virtue of our generosity, by virtue of our allowing ourselves to be loved. How hard is that, right? People who embrace more strengths across more virtue areas tend to flourish more. We'll say more next week about that. We'll spend a lot more time next week about that. Several studies yield remarkable findings. Barbara Fredrickson from the University of Michigan has a similar theory to Seligman's, but in her research, she actually identified statistically that positive emotions practice broaden our abiding intellectual, physical, and social resources. We become more resilient when we practice these over and over and repetitively. They become natural. When we're in a positive mood, people like us better, there's better friendships experience, there's more wholesome love experience, and coalitions are more likely to cement in life. That's pretty intuitive, right? It would make sense. But do you understand how that breeds? The more healthy relationships that result, the more likely it breeds more happiness too. Happy people remember more good events than actually happen, statistically. They forget more bad events. Happy people, this is all Barbara Fredrickson's theory, happier people are markedly more satisfied with their jobs. Happy people endure pain better. They take more health and safety precautions when threatened. And positive emotions undo negative emotions. That is, happiness is propagative of more positive emotions and experiences. The happier we are, the more happy we will be. Happy people are more altruistic, empathetic, and generous, which are all win-win scenarios. That should tell us something theological too, right? Also, their mindset is expansive and tolerant and creative, open to new ideas and new experiences. hope all that is making some sense. It's a lot of science thrown at you in kind of summary statements. But again, the research is behind all of that. So let's dig into a little bit of the kind of, a little more didactic perhaps. The happiness formula, Seligman suggests, is H equals S plus C plus V. First time I saw that, I was like, oh God. Happiness is your enduring level of happiness in life, not your momentary. So we can all have momentary happiness, you know. Have a grandbaby delivered, you get happy, right? But this is the longer term happiness we're talking about. And it's a factor of your set range, which is your biological, your genetic set point. Some people are just designed evolutionarily, genetically, to be happier than others. We kind of already know that, don't we? Some people just come out of the womb. God knows that I have two children. I love them both dearly. But one came out of the womb happier than the other one ever will be. I don't understand that, but it just is. There's an interesting study of 22 people who won major lotteries. And they were initially very happy. But over time, they reverted to their baseline level of happiness and were statistically no more happy than the general population, even though they had won their thousands and millions. Set range, our biological set point, determines a lot. He suggests about 50% of your predicted happiness. There's a lot of information about depression. Depression is almost always episodic. And let me just stop here and say that clinical depression is something that I've treated as a physician for 20 plus years. It is real. It is significant. And none of this is intended to minimize it or to discourage you from seeking your clinical support team that you normally have if you battle with depression, either episodically or chronically. But most depression is episodic. Most recover within a few months. He did some interesting research on spinal cord accident victims. Paraplegics first, within 8 weeks, they report more positive emotion than negative emotion, and within a few years, they are happy as the average, as the rest of the population. People with extreme quadriplegia, which is paralysis from the neck down, 84% consider their life to be average or above average in terms of satisfaction with their life compared to the public. Is that not remarkable? Yeah. That's all I'll say right now about depression. Again, I'm not trying to minimize it, and please do not take this as a prescription to do something different than you're under your doctor's care. I don't want to be sued. Part of the problem, let me go back to the circumstances of your life, we'll talk more about in a minute, and the V factor, the factor under your voluntary control. The circumstances of your life are just your lot in life. Your first spouse died, and you've battled a chronic autoimmune disease for several years. Those are factors, circumstances in your life. The hopeful thing about all of this is that in the science, that's only predictive of 8 to 15% of the total happiness possibility for you. So you can have a really shitty life, and those circumstances are only about up to 15%. The rest of it is what you decide to make with it and your genetics, right? There's some movement there to make, but the real place to move is in the voluntary control places where we're going. Let me just caution about what he calls, and others call, the hedonic treadmill, and that is that we really like good things in life when they come our way. If we win the lottery, if we get a discount, or we come into some money unexpectedly, or we make a new friend, or whatever, we adapt quickly to those good things. The The clinical word is tachyphylaxis. We get it, and then over time, it becomes less and less of a bump in our experience of it, and so we need more and more of them, more frequently, or larger ones. And so we're on this kind of hedonic treadmill where we just are trying to get more and more positive experiences. This is where folks who have the pathology of addictions will end up running in very dysfunctional ways, trying to get one more feel-good. And it may not be the necessarily destructive things of drugs or alcohol. It could be, but it could be things like compulsive buying, shopping. It could be compulsive promiscuity. It could be any number of things where we're trying to get those. So I'm just trying to highlight some of the pitfalls with this. Money, interestingly enough, does not have a positive impact on life satisfaction or happiness over and above a certain threshold. And that threshold appears to be at about $8,000 per capita income. Over and above $8,000, you add another penny to it, and it doesn't increase happiness. The statistic here is they looked at 40 different nations and asked, how satisfied are you with your life on the whole these days? And again, those under $8,000 per capita, horrible life satisfaction, because they're not getting basic subsistence, right? But everyone over and above $8,000, it was not statistically predictive that one more dollar would add more. And in fact, Denmark has triple the life satisfaction that the United Kingdom does, and even more so than the United States does in his research, which is now several years old, but it could be updated, and I think still predictive that certain countries manage to do this better than others. We could talk about why we think that is. Other contributors to happiness that have been corroborated in the science, active participation in religion does have a modest effect. Age, the older you are, the happier, usually, and marriage does as well. So, changing the external circumstances. Live in an affluent democracy, not an impoverished dictatorship. There's a strong effect for that. Marry or have a life partner, there's a robust effect, but they have not been able to document that it's a causal benefit. You see what I'm saying? We know that people who are married or have life partners have generally higher life satisfaction, but we don't know that it's because specifically that they have that. That's because they're married. Avoid negative events and negative emotions has a moderate effect. Acquire a rich social network has a robust effect, but again, perhaps not causal. And getting religion. We've got religion. No apparent correlation, though, with increasing happiness. Making more money, again, above that threshold. The more materialistic you are, actually, the less happy you are. Staying healthy. Actually, you would think it would, but it really doesn't. Subjective health, not objective health, is what matters most. Again, quadriplegics may feel like they are happier than many of us. Getting more education has no apparent effect on the level of happiness. I hate to tell you, but PhDs are not generally happier than those with high school education. Or MDs, or whatever the case may be. And changing your race or moving to a more pleasant climate. I told my wife that, sorry, honey, we can't move to Hawaii when we retire because it has no benefit to our life. She said, we can test the hypothesis. So, again, H equals S plus C plus V. Your biological set point is about half your score on happiness tests. And then let's look at the V factors under your voluntary control. They can lastingly help in getting you to a higher level of happiness and life satisfaction, but it is hard work. This is not easy stuff. This is lifelong work, which is, I suppose, why we're all here tonight, right? So ways that you can move the needle on that V factor is look for the positive emotions that you feel about the past. Looking back and reorienting what has happened in your past in ways that you can retell your story, relearn your story, and let go of an ideology that says that you were the victim. Now, I am not trying to suggest that people who were abuse victims need to forget that. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm saying is how we dwell on that, how we perceive and remember and tell that, makes a difference in how we're able to live the present and look to the future. And then let me just extend an invitation. If that stops someone cold or upset, please let's just have a conversation about it. I don't want to, I'm making some very broad blanket statements here out of the research, but it may not apply to your individual situation. So let's have a conversation outside of Wednesday evenings about that. I'd be delighted for that. Secondly, release the negative emotions. Anger is the most predictive negative emotion as an adverse outcome for your happiness. They looked at 255 medical students, and they tracked them over decades, and the angriest on a scale of 1 to 5, those who were on the 5 angriest scale, were 5 times more likely to have heart disease in their lifetime than those who were 1 on the scale, at least. Anger was the most predictive, more than the genetics even, more than the other life factors in this research. I see Phil Haas over there thinking group health needs to figure this one out, and he's going to tell me, Steve, you got it all wrong. Which may be the case, but I'm quoting the science here. So. See him if you're a group health person. Third, voluntarily change your memories. Again, as I'm talking about, we decide how it is that we frame our past. It's an important part of the work that we do. Fourth, increase your gratitude about good things in your past, highlighting what has happened that's good. And five, learn how to forgive past wrongs. Now, part of the homework that I'm going to invite you to do is a couple of exercises in gratitude and one about forgiving, and I'll talk about that as we're wrapping up here in a few minutes. Living in the present, with his language of flow, or of engagement in the present, is about savoring the pleasures of life here and now, and the gratifying experiences in life. Some of you may have kind of tried to live by the notion of carpe diem. I'm not sure that that's exactly the same. Carpe diem has a dark side to it, in that you're not remembering the past and you're not looking to the future. Just blow it out today. That's not what we're talking about. This is about, for your momentary present, how you live presently and are mindful of it and are grateful for it. And he suggests this language of savoring, that we bask in the positive experience, that we give thanks for it, that we marvel in it, and that we luxuriate in it, which means that we dive in with all the senses. You ever had that just holy meal with a good friend or a life partner or around a table with some dear friends, and you taste that first bite, and it's just, you know, it's just mushrooms and cream sauce. Oh my God, it has this kind of, the video's on, but orgasmic experience. You know what I'm talking about? Anybody?
Yeah.
All right.
Amen.
Savoring those. And the meals are where we can really kind of capture that. Enjoy your meals. Enjoy it with someone else. It's been said, you can eat food, but you have to have someone else with you to have a meal, to share a meal. There's this experience of holiness that comes with that. He doesn't use that word, I. But I would also say that worship is about savoring the presence, the present. We talk about praise, we talk about glory, we talk about doxology, that means praise or glory. We talk about communion. All of that is about the moment right in front of us and how we engage that. It's about sharing with others. It's about memory building. It's about sharpening our perceptions, honing them so that they become more naturally turned on. And it's about absorbing it all, bringing it in. So again, as I said, I've got handouts up here. Let me just go ahead and point to what I've got here. We will put, Liz is gracious enough to be recording this. Several people were not able to be here and they asked for that. We'll figure out how to get that on the website along with a copy of the slides. But for those of you who may not have access to a computer, I've got a few copies of the slides here. And then these other three handouts, one is a general happiness scale. This is out of Seligman's work. The second one is a gratitude exercise. In his research, he said when he does this with students in the classroom, they actually have a gratitude night every semester. And universally, at the University of Pennsylvania, it is the highest rated course and the highest rated day. You're nodding your head. Do you know this? Yeah. The highest rated day in this class on all of the University of Pennsylvania campus. What it is an invitation to think about someone whom you did not say thank you to in your past and write out your note about what you want to say to that person and then invite them to a meal or to a restaurant or to a bar or to your home or whatever the case may be and read your letter with eye contact and then listen to them respond. He said it's the most remarkable, transformative thing that he does in all of his teaching. The flip side of that is how to forgive, five steps that he suggests. And if you have someone that you need to forgive, or how you might frame something in which you need forgiveness in your own life, this is an exercise that might help you do that. So that's it for two. So I said the happiness scale is here. The satisfaction with life scale is a slight orient off of that, and then the gratitude survey. Again, positive emotions, gratitude, love all have to go together for the thing to measure up. So you're welcome to come take one in just a few minutes. There's more information at authentichappiness.com, or you can Google Martin Seligman at University of Penn, and you get all sorts of information. Next week, we'll talk about human flourishing, the eudaimonia that I mentioned at the outset. We'll talk about character strengths as predictors of well-being. And we'll talk about what I think are some pitfalls in this, all of this. And let me just highlight the bibliography will be on there as well. And say we've got about 10 minutes or so. Please help me remember to break things down. I don't want to be the only one doing this at the end. But not everyone has to. It's an invitation. Questions, comments, conversation. Yes, Eric.
You mentioned 50% of the genetics predict happiness, or something like the other. How the split was in there.
So, of your general happiness life, not momentary, but general happiness, 50% is predicted by your genetics.
And what about the other?
And then 8 to 15% are the circumstances, the lot in life. And then the rest is the variable factors. But again, as I said, the variable factors are where you can really move the needle, but it's hard work. It's not something that we just say, oh, today I'm going to be happier and it happens. It's really practicing over years for that to happen. Yeah. Yeah.
Steve, I was curious on one of the slides, you mentioned a factor that didn't change happiness much. It was one about being happy retiring in Hawaii. But it also mentioned changing your race. And since I haven't read the text, I'm wondering if you could give a couple more sentences about what he intended behind that statement.
Yeah, I should have probably stated that differently. People who are in minorities are not less happy, even though they often have more challenges in terms of discrimination, socioeconomic, they are not less happy than people in the majority race. So if a black person in America were to become white, that doesn't guarantee more happiness, is what the change really tells us. Yeah, Doug.
Do any of the studies talk about the role of the arts and beauty in terms of happiness?
Yeah, so one of the strengths in the spirituality and transcendence is beauty and excellence, and how we engage beauty and excellence is a part of that. Yeah, we'll talk about it next week in more detail. Yeah, Mike?
So was there any study done to show the living circumstances someone's in and how that affects happiness? So if you're living, there's gunfire out every night, and water being turned off, and drug dealers are coming into the house versus those of us that have homes, we don't worry about water and electricity and all that.
Right. So again, up to a certain subsistence level, that $8,000 of earning power, dramatic increase in happiness, but over and above that, not. And the change in what I hear you saying is the socioeconomic, political, economic realities of a person's life. Certain parts of Baltimore does not mean necessarily predictive of less happiness than Medina, for example.
We were actually in Denmark last month, and we talked about the happiness index with the Danish people sometimes, and they were really consistent in that it's kind of echoing what you're saying about kind of having the subsistence taken care of. So they said repeatedly, we just don't worry about healthcare or getting older and who's going to take care of us, because that baseline is covered, so we have no excuse to not be really happy. And it was really interesting. But it was almost like it was a national psyche. About being, it was almost like it was taught, you know, like, anyway. So I thought that was interesting.
I think that's the implication, is that it is. There is an equity across the populace there that does not exist.
Right, with access to stuff, you know. It's
And I would, this is not stated in the science, but I would extrapolate that fear is a big part of the
addiction. Yeah, it seemed like that.
It'd be really hard for this country to achieve that, because in this country it seems like the real religion is social Darwinism and free market fundamentalism, which kind of blows out all the way, the notion of having a safety net.
Yeah, I mean, that's the subject matter for another course, social Darwinism. Yeah, Deborah. So thank you for raising that question. What we're not talking about is momentary anger. Clearly, and I should have spelled this out, so again, thank you. Clearly, anger has to come out. It does come out. If we suppress it over here, it comes out over here in some other way. We cannot suppress anger. But momentary anger has a functional benefit. I think the evolutionary benefit too. Jesus got angry and turned the money tables over, but then he stood and watched the poor widow woman come up and make her offering, and he had compassion for her. So the anger went to something else. That's the invitation. It's the whack-a-mole phenomenon. If you press your anger down here, it's going to come up over here. Y'all know whack-a-mole? It's a carnival game. Yeah, arcade game. You push one down, you're whacking it, and you push it here, and it pops up over here, or pops up over here. We cannot escape our anger, but we have to deal with it in ways that we release it instead of letting it just throttle. Yeah. So thanks for asking that. Yeah, Jeff.
You mentioned fear just a minute ago, and I don't know how that fits into this, but I remember when Walter Brueggemann was here, and we talked a lot about how fear is one of the controlling elements in our theology as well as in our society and things. And some of the strengths and virtues are. Does that come out again, or do you talk about that more later, or is that sort of, it seems like it's counter to what the point is, I suppose, but it seems like such an important issue that we're dealing with or not dealing with successfully in our culture, so that's why I asked.
Yeah, we'll talk about a little of it next week with courage. And then we'll talk more even in the third week with Brene Brown's notion of courage and wholeheartedness. You know, the word courage actually is a French derivative of the word cœur for heart. It's about being wholehearted. And wholehearted is about releasing the fear that tamps it down so it can't function. It doesn't mean that fear doesn't exist. It just means put it in the proper orientation so that you're able to act in a certain way. And Seligman doesn't go quite in that direction. He uses more of this notion of valor. We'll talk some about it next week. But I think we're dancing around the same things. And ultimately, I think how we embrace, how we deal with fear is as central a piece of the work that we have to do as Christians, for sure, but I think as humans on the planet, certainly as Americans, so much is driven by fear these days. Yeah. Yep. Marilyn, good to have you back, by the way.
I'm curious about that $8,000 as a figure for GBP.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, that's a fairly confusing concept, even for someone who's got an economics degree. So I'm just wondering if you can unpack that a little bit more, because did I hear you also say that that was across 40 countries?
Yes, it was across 40 countries. It's a few years old, so the 8,000 may be indexed up to something more than that now, but the principle is there no matter what the number is. That over and above a certain subsistence level of availability of resource in dollar figures, over and above that, there's no more increase in predicting one's happiness.
Okay, I think that's an important point, isn't it? Because I think people are inclined to think that you're saying over $8,000 per year income for a and that's
not what that's. No, thank you for that. It's GDP. Yeah.
It's, yeah. I've seen numbers many years ago about that, but it's, yeah, I mean, you don't guess.
Let me back it up and say, just don't even worry about the 8,000. If people in a certain nation have a basic level of subsistence, they are statistically as happy as the wealthiest nation in the world.
And that's subsistence, not comfort. Subsistence.
Well, I think that was the theory of that benchmark of 8,000, is that that's what it would mean to get housing, shelter, food, clothing, education, the basic services necessary. I'm happy to read up on that and report back next week if you like.
I think it's supposed to be 70,000 in this
region.
That's why that's.
Say again.
It's supposed to be 70,000 a year. That's why that CEO, that local CEO, everybody raised 70,000. Because there was some study that said that if you make about $70,000 a year, your happiness is greatly increased. And then above $70,000 a year, it doesn't really matter.
70. Are you saying 70,000?
Yeah,
that's not what this science says. So, all right, guys.
It's important to keep going back to that's the non-income for each person, because in Seattle we would not get subsistence for $8,000
right.
a year.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks for saying that. For clarifying that, Marilyn. Jim.
I know there's some research somewhere that pegs happiness to either income or personal possessions in terms of how you think your neighbor is doing. So there's some research that shows that there's some variability depending upon your attitude toward what this fixed point, the 8,000 or whatever that represents. So I'm wondering how that, bring that into the So it's, are they going to be, if they're in, let's say, more relatively more materialistic kind of?
Did y'all hear the question? So Jim is suggesting that there's some evidence somewhere that happiness is relative to how you understand your position in life compared to your neighbor's position in life.
Right.
And that may be, but this science doesn't bear that out. Having said that, let me say it hasn't been studied in a way that it's reported as a negative to what you just said. But having said that, if I go back to the comments about Denmark, where there's equity of the basic services, then there isn't this need to keep up with the Joneses in the same way, perhaps.
The perception of justice in terms of view.
One more question and then we'll quit. Yep, Phil.
This isn't a question, it's an answer, but I did the math and the per capita GDP here is 40,000.
Yeah.
40,000. So 5 times the rate.
Yeah.
Not surprised.
Is it? Well. If you feel like you don't have a fair shake in life in terms of your money to be happy, let's have a conversation. The point is that money is not the principal driver in life. That is everyone able to catch
through? We're American.
Yeah, that's right. All right. Everyone, thank you so much. Next week.